Hello, it's me, Darcy, and I am here with the lovely Kristen from Mom Launch, and we are going to talk about transitions, motherhood transitions, women in transition, life transitions, all things transition. So let's start off with Kristen. Tell me a little bit about Mom Launch.
I got this company started because I was in my own kind of transition and really floundering and not clear about how I was going to do what I wanted to do once I finally figured it out, and not feeling like I had enough support and feeling like there were some things about being a mom and doing a career transition that felt different than any other time that I'd ever tried to make a career change. And over the years and helping people, knowing that there were things that were different about being in a career transition as a mom and thinking about things outside of myself. And it was a much scarier process for me. And I thought, what if I could help moms and make this process a little bit easier for them? So that's why I got started.
So, Mom Launch will be trainings, workshops, videos.
All of the above. So one-on-one coaching, as well as online. I'm doing a lot of resources online so that I can reach more moms, and also doing the coaching, right now, Zoom. And I have done the coaching one-on-one face-to-face, but of course we'll see where we go over the next 6 months to a year and how that'll play out. But a lot of the stuff is available and will be available on my website, and there'll be trainings around career transitions and how moms can either re-enter the workforce, starting their own companies, or going to work for other organizations, and how to make that process happen in a shorter amount of time and with more support.
Yeah. There's one word that describes parenting. It has to be transition. Seems to be a universal assumption when we go to have our first child that I'm going to be me and the baby's going to join me in the world and the baby's going to probably go in a backpack while I go about my life traveling and going to restaurants
Right.
and that it is a huge almost slap in the face, right? The day you take the baby home and realize that you are literally no longer the same person. And the next maybe 20 years
Right.
is an identity shift.
That's exactly what I'm hearing from moms, and that identity piece of not recognizing. A lot of moms say, when did this happen? Like, when did I get lost? When did I get off track? And how do I get back on track? It's like you said, it's that whole period of time between bringing a baby home and sending them out into the world, where the moms that I have worked with really struggle with trying to find themselves again and giving up so much of who they are and their own identity in the process of raising kids makes it so much more difficult for those transitions to happen in a smooth and easy way because they feel so lost and isolated and alone, and like their situation is not similar to anyone else's. When in truth, we all, as my experience, have a lot of that identity piece that gets lost, and not recognizing or knowing how to get back to that, and also recognizing that there are parts of us that change over the period of becoming a mom, and what drives us and what we're interested in is not going to be the same as it was before we had kids, and recognizing that piece as well. And there's a lot of grief involved in that process.
Our culture is so steeped in this idea of the joy and magic of motherhood, right? And so you have a baby and you're supposed to be in love and sparkling and your hair is thicker and everything is glorious. And for so many moms who wake up in that first month or never go to sleep at all in that first month, it isn't like that. It isn't all great. And what it is this hard new job, right? And one that lots of us are really excited about doing, but is way harder than we expected. There is a complete identity shift. And I think moms differ in terms of how much they embrace that identity shift in, right? Like some moms, I think, really are excited about it and they are eager to kind of let go of some of the things that they were before. And it can feel good, right? Like it can feel nice for some moms to dive deep into that and put on the mom hat. And then maybe that's the only hat, because the mom hat will consume you, right? Like the mom hat will take every ounce of everything that you are, and then ask for more, as if you're not giving enough. And there's no end to the jobs and the needs and the fun things too, like the creating and the joy in it. There's no end to it, and it can continue to eclipse the other parts of us. And I find that somewhere around kindergarten or first grade, they experience a very loud break, a very loud absence of something, right? That they go from being fully consumed with the mom identity to their child developmentally needing space from them. So their child is then saying, nope, I'm gonna move away from you in a way that creates this hole for you. And that's when I find that for a certain group of moms, maybe all to some extent, there's a transition back, right? Like I have to fill in this identity piece with something about me. Right. And that's a time when a couple things happen. Number one, for some of us, we wake up and didn't even realize we were lost, right? Mm-hmm. Like you said, they're trying to figure out how to not be lost or how to find their way again. And for some people, there's a real moment in time when they are realizing, oh my gosh, it's been 6 years of all mama all the time. I didn't even realize I was missing. And so then there's a grief and sometimes a reluctance, like, should I hang on to that?
Right.
Or do I fill it in? Right. Do I go a different direction? A transition of finding myself again as a unique and individual person within the context of the motherhood identity.
Because it's not one extreme to the other, that black and white thinking of I wasn't a mom, now I am, and then this transition period that you're talking about, kindergarten, first, second grade, where moms, there's a point where I see that we all have to make decisions with our kids and what we want to do in ourselves. Is they're recognizing that stepping back is starting to happen for them and for the kids, and there's a big decision for them to make around that, which is, do I just stay really focused on my identity as a mom, or can I step into more of who I am, what I love to do, what's important to me, and am I willing to do the work to make that transition? And I see moms that really struggle. Some of them are so excited to do it and can't wait to get back to some things for themselves. And other moms have put so much of their identity into these kids and raising them that they really struggle with finding the places inside themselves that provide them worth and meaning and the energy to do things outside of child rearing. And it's a real struggle, especially for moms, because we still have so much pressure on ourselves to, if we're working outside of the home, to do that, to still have a lot of the responsibilities around the home and with child rearing. And now that so many of us are home and our kids are home, being homeschooled, and 80% of the workforce that has left the workforce has been women, we have so much more pressure on us to do all of these things and still at the same time get back to ourselves. And I think that's a huge struggle. And I know for me personally, I had to give myself permission to get back to myself. For me, it was little by little. It was step by step and really getting back to the things that before our daughter was born brought me life and invigorated me. And at that time, it didn't have a lot to do with my career. It had more to do with the things that helped me move myself along in the day, taking care of myself with my exercise and meditation and journaling, the kinds of things that brought me back to who I am, to take my focus outside of the rest of the world. And also being really honest with myself, getting support, and reaching out to the mamas in my world that had been through that transition, asking them questions. because I felt really alone. And I also felt guilty, the mom guilt that we talk about so much, particularly as moms go back to work. The guilt of, what if I'm not going to be there when my daughter needs me? What if she gets really sick? Or what if I can't pick her up at school because I'm working or I'm doing something else? And, or any of the things that I struggled with as a mom that I know moms talk about and have to work through, was really hard for me to grapple with. So little steps at a time. And I was lucky in that I didn't have to hit the ground running when our daughter was school age. And I feel really fortunate about that. And there are moms out there that have to hit the ground running when their kids go back to school or go to school, and they have to bring in income and find that balance and get clear about what they want to do. And it's a real struggle, but it brought me to my knees. I remember backing out of the driveway on more than one occasion in tears as I waved to my kiddo goodbye in the window, and just how heartbreaking it was. And really questioning my decisions all of the time. And what was I doing to my kid? And was I damaging her by not being available all the time? And that struggle and that guilt, and then recognizing it was so important for me to do this for me, and I needed to set an example for her of me taking care of myself.
That is such an important concept. Our parenting culture has twisted its way into a narrative of, I am being a good parent if I meet all of my kids' needs all of the time, with zero exception, right? That there is so much pressure and identity wrapped up in being a good mom means giving all of myself to that identity, right? To that.
All of the time. Yep.
All of the time. And that if I don't meet my child's needs all of the time, then I am failing / harming them. And this is a really interesting concept, because if we were in fact able to meet our kids' needs all of the time without them suffering, I think we would be doing them a huge disservice, and we would raise terrible human beings who would have no resiliency or coping skills or be able to be self-reliant or trust other people or interact with anyone other than us. And we would be forced to follow them around for the rest of their lives, meeting their every need forever. So the concept is faulty, right? Like that seems clear just in like articulating that out loud. Of course, my kid needs to experience some suffering or some life or some moments to try to solve their own problems in order to gain the human skills that I want them to have. Of course, in the moment of being a mom, that moment never comes where it feels good to let my kids suffer, right? Where I feel good about prioritizing something over them. However, children absorb who we are, right? The essence of who we are, the essence of our family culture, the essence of how we interact with each other in terms of our interpersonal relationships with each other in the family. And that includes me as a mom being a human who is part of this equation, right? A human with her own wants and needs and desires and priorities and interests. Those things matter. And that if I want to raise children who have those skills, who are resilient and empathic and kind and work well with other people and can prioritize other people and can prioritize themselves also, if I want to raise a child with all of those things, then I need to do those things. So prioritizing myself is not just good for my mental health and something that my psychologist wants me to do. It is good parenting, right? It is modeling how to live a vibrant, effective life for my children. And somehow we have gotten away from the understanding that that is parenting, right? Parenting is not running around behind them, cleaning up their messes. And, you know, that's part of it. But it's also just being a human with them and negotiating life with them And having mom not be available because mom is working, and that's okay. That doesn't mean that I'm neglecting them. And we've really lost that. And because we've lost that, we're constantly seeing it as a choice. Either I'm parenting or I'm working. Right. Either I'm parenting or I'm going for a run to take care of myself. Either I'm parenting or I'm prioritizing myself. And that is, to me, one of the huge reasons that we struggle so much with this part of the transition, right? The transition into motherhood is like falling off a cliff, and it's just going to happen, and you're just going to do it, and you're going to find your wings and fly and figure that out. But the climb back to finding myself, like this concept of finding myself is being a good parent, like we somehow have to rewrite our parenting culture right now.
My experience is that what I talk to moms about and when I've had these self conversations around is the modeling piece. So not only for my daughter, but for kids when moms are getting ready to get back into the workforce, we're showing our kids, we're not just telling them, but we're showing them that we're committed to taking care of ourselves and committed to the family. And it's not a one or the other, it's both. And that is a constant message. And I recognize there are times where I have to make decisions. My daughter comes up to me, I'm on my laptop, I'm working on something, and she says, "Mom, I want your attention. You've been on your computer all day." And I understand it. And so in those moments, taking a pause, checking in, and then getting back to it until I can be done, and setting some of those boundaries, but also being an example to her around, I'm worth this. This means a lot to me. And bringing her into this process of seeing what I'm doing, bouncing ideas off of her. She's at an age now where I can ask her, what do you think about this picture or what this meant? And she gets involved and connected.
Yes.
Which is really wonderful for her and for me. So it's something we can connect around. And she also witnesses me doing things for myself, and it also helps my family. And so talking to moms about that modeling behavior and recognizing that it's not always the easiest thing to do, but being able to set some boundaries and have that balance of it's not one or the other, like you were talking about, it's both. It's both and. It's hard to go back to work, and for those of us that's where we're at, we want to do, it's a really important part of our process, and our kids need to see that. And it also gives them a chance, as you talked about the resilience piece, and recognizing that their world is not just about them. And for me as a woman, giving my daughter the message that my job is not just to take care of her. My job is to take care of me and support and love my family and to take care of my kiddo. But as a woman, I want her to see that my value and my worth are attached to a lot of different things, not just raising her.
There is a thing that I talk about a lot in parenting sessions, generally with like parents of preschoolers, is where this is really setting in. But it's the power and practice of being unavailable sometimes to our kids. And that being a good parent, like we said, doesn't require me to be available all the time, and doing so really hinders my kids. So I will often coach parents to practice saying, you know, your kid needs something, anything, red cup or glass milk or just to play with you, saying, "Oh, I'm not available right now." And that phrase is often so hard for new moms. And the first thing they'll say when I talk about this concept is they'll say, "But what if I am available?" I'm like, no, this is not actually about you right now, right? This is about teaching your kid that they might have to wait. They might have to wait. They might have to solve it for themselves. They might have to find someone else to help them. They might have to, you know, get their sibling or their other parent or, right? Like that these are all really good skills that your preschooler / 16-year-old need to understand, right? That mom is not available right now. And not with a, "Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry, I'm ruining your life because I'm not available." Not because I have to be unavailable, which is the other thing. I really want to, but I have to work, right? I have to work. Otherwise, I would totally be meeting all of your time, all of your needs. But just as simply like, I'm not available to help you with that right now. I might be available in about 5 minutes. What are your options? What else can you do, right? First of all, there's a teaching them on the kids' side. There's a teaching them to like notice, oh, mom is cooking dinner and washing dishes and juggling things on her head. And maybe she can't, you know, carry my book for me at this moment, right? So there's that noticing other people and starting to differentiate, right? Starting to understand that we are separate human beings walking down a path together, and that this gives the kids a lot of skills. It also is one of the first steps often that new mamas or not so new mamas need in their own differentiation, right? Yes. Our children are born to leave us. They will push. They will fight for that space and push for that space. And if we are not differentiating ourselves, then we'll cling to them, right? And in fact, impede their development.
Yes.
So we need that natural progression of the separation between my child and myself. And sometimes the easiest place to start is just with that line. I'm not available right now. And then noticing inside of us how hard that is. Yes. Sometimes when we first try it, right, we're like, not available right now. And our kid freaks out and has a little tantrum and does whatever. And I'm over there like watching the clock, waiting until I can be available, right? I said 5 minutes, so I'm going to hold my ground, wait 5 minutes. And we all realized that, oh, okay, that was okay. It was okay for me not to be available for 5 minutes. And then to start to kind of work that understanding that even though I wasn't available to, you know, read the book or get the red cup or whatever it was, I'm still parenting, right? Like I'm not neglecting my child. This is not abuse or abandonment. This is good parenting of prioritizing everybody in the family and in the relationship, and in so kind of growing myself as much as growing my children.
And that concept of the thing that I have in my head a lot and I talk to moms about is that modeling piece of how am I setting an example for my daughter? How are you setting an example for your kids around what it's going to be like for them out in the world and in the workplace? Mm-hmm. And where do we draw the line of if I identify myself so much around my kid and I don't set some of those boundaries? And you're right, like the first time of me saying I'm not available was so uncomfortable. And oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And it just, and the shock on her, like, I'm sorry, what? Yes. And just practicing that over time and over time. And now, you know, she's at an age where I can really explain and go into things if I want to. And other times it's like, that's not an option right now. You can do this or you can figure it out and I'll be available in a little while. And it's more of that habit. But if I haven't done enough of the work around separating my own identity and what's important to me and what my values are around whatever it is I'm working on, then I get pulled into her so much easier. Mm-hmm. And not having that clarity around what's important and my drive and focus lets me go back into this place where I'm doing this again. And it's not helpful for either one of us. And it's still a struggle for me as a mom, but I'm much more clear and I have a lot more skills and a lot more practice around it. And I don't want my kid to think that when she raises her hand or she needs something, the world stops. Right. I mean, what kind of service am I providing for her around and that messaging? And it's hard for moms. It is a hard place to start, but it's so important.
We're talking about or coaching mom through moving back into a career, but sometimes we're coaching a mom just into starting to go running again or, right? Like, you know, picking up a hobby that they used to love or empowering themselves to read a non-parenting book for an hour. Kind of finding any of those me moments, right? With career, I feel like our culture also has a very all or nothing identity, very similar to our mom identity, right? Is that it's all encompassing. This is your number one title and you only get one. So right. Pick your title and then right. do it 150% and that's all that you get. And so right. because we don't do balance very well, we don't like to have more than one emotion at a time. We don't like to, you know, be focused on more than one kind of path at a time. But in reality, we have lots of paths going, right? Like yes. I'm developing as a mom and I'm developing as a psychologist or whatever I am. And I might have 3 or 4 or 6 or 10 different areas of growth and change and evolution in me at any one time. Our culture is just really bad at noticing that. So yes. that decision to move from one all-encompassing identity into another all-encompassing identity feels impossible because we don't know how to take them both down to a reasonable understanding that these are part of my bigger identity. And it's interesting because even saying that out loud, that like my parenting identity is a piece of the pie, feels a little like, am I betraying something? Like, shouldn't that be the most important thing in my life?
Yeah.
Because we don't know how to be in that space.
No, it's the and space of being a parent and doing things for myself, whether it's having a career or starting a business or doing something outside of being a parent and that transition. And I think the other thing is that what I hear where moms get stuck is they get overwhelmed with even thinking, because we now, particularly in the United States, there's this message of, you know, live your life's purpose, find your purpose in your work and do that. And there's this pressure of first, there's only one thing and we have to figure out what it is. And if we don't figure out what it is,
don't you know already? What's wrong?
Right, exactly.
Haven't you known since third grade? Like, I don't, it's crazy that you don't know.
Exactly. No.
Don't have a one thing that we've known since third grade that, right? Like, that's not reality.
It's not reality. And having that pressure continues to block people from actually figuring some things out that they're interested in. And also recognizing it's probably going to change.
Right.
Many times. I mean, what I wanted to do in my 20s and in my 30s and when I was in high, it's changed in my 40s and it evolves. And just not putting that pressure on myself, it's analysis paralysis of, well, I have to figure out what that one thing is. And until I figure it out, I can't do anything. And rather than just kind of going with, well, let's go down this path and see where this leads. And sometimes that just means giving myself or my clients, giving themselves some time for reflection and curiosity and exploration. Mm-hmm. A good example for me is I was looking online for some classes for my daughter and I found this crochet class. And I thought, I have no idea how to crochet. Maybe that would be kind of fun for me to pursue. So I took this class. It was a local class. I went and I made this cowl. Well, it took a while in the class. It was not natural for me at the class. And I had to stay after and the teacher helped me. And I finally got, she could send me out the door far enough into the project. She felt like I could finish it on my own. So I did. And it turned into this cowl and I gave it to my mom for Christmas. And it has turned into, that was 5 or 6 years ago. And it's turned into this thing that I love to do. And I make them for all kinds of reasons now. And it's a creative outlet for me. I'm not going to do anything with it in my business, but what it did was it gave me permission to be curious about something and develop an interest and not make it be a be all end all. Well, if I could make a lot of money or if I'm not perfect at it, then it's not worth it. But it's just that message that we get, particularly in America, of you have to find your passion and you have to do that for your career and to be successful.
I really like that these kinds of things can make our life better and we don't always have to go to this super extreme, right? And that even if I'm doing something that I might not be great at, that is not making money, that is not justified, I still may choose to do it over meeting your needs in this moment.
Right. Exactly.
Like, I can still prioritize me finding time to crochet or whatever, even if it's not my life passion, that I don't have to have it be that in order to justify letting it have a space within our family culture.
Exactly. And the identity piece around it. So I remember sitting down and crocheting, and my husband looked over, he really said these words to me, "Who are you?" Because I have a math brain, I'm a left brain thinker, I'm not known for creative and doing a lot of arts and creating things. And I remember him looking at me and saying that, and I thought, I'm changing. Like, what I'm interested in and what is driving me is changing, and I'm going with it.
Yeah.
And it's been so much fun to just give myself that permission to be curious and explore things that really have to do with other than I'm curious. It fills me up. And then when I got to say, when I finished a hat and I put that pom-pom on there, I'm so happy. It's so satisfying. Mm-hmm. And 6 years ago before I started, I never would have assumed that would be something I would pick up. But I always encourage moms to explore places where there's an intrinsic value to them. And it doesn't have to be defined by anything outside of themselves. Mm-hmm. But just be willing to explore and consider different things. And then that can lead to things in relationship to their careers that they never would have assumed possible.
Mm-hmm. And what a gift.
Yeah. And I just want moms to know that they're not alone in this process.
It's amazing how we can feel alone in something that is so kind of universally felt.
It is.
Amongst moms. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I hear so many moms when I'm talking to them about what they're good at and what their natural abilities are and what their interests are. They don't feel like it's worth anything, or they don't feel like the fact that they've been at home for a period of time, if they've left the workforce and been working from home as a mom, re-entering, they're really questioning their skills, how to transition, and what their worth is. But just to get in touch with that intrinsic value and our own worth, and being able to stand up for that out in the workplace, is something I wish every mom could do and have the skills and support around.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Kristen. It's been lovely. Thank you for sharing your story, and I'm super excited about Mom Launch. I think it's going to be so helpful for so many mamas.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. This has been so much fun, and I'm so grateful for what you're doing to support families and help us be great parents.